We'd like to speak today about what shuls and davening is all about. It's something that's very interesting, that there are many points over here that when you put them together and you align them together, you can understand the power of tefillah. Let's start by just explaining the very first thing that the Kabbalah, in Sifrei Kabbalah, the Ramchal, in his Sifrei Kabbalah explains, and that is that every person has five different steps, and those are Echal, Levush, Guf, Nefesh, Ruach. Four different steps. What are those things? Echal, it's the house. Just like every person has a house, he lives and dwells in a house. The Levush is the cloth. Guf is the body. Nefesh is the soul. Ruach is the spirit. What are those things? We have to realize that whenever we enter a shul, we have to feel that we're entering also within ourselves, inner part. We're entering the walls of the shul, and we're entering inside. It's not just a place that we're entering, but rather we're coming closer to our inner ability, our inner part, and we being able with that bring out more of ourselves, and that is starts with the building itself. You walk inside and you walk within yourself into the clothing and into the body. Levush, guf, nefesh. Nefesh is the thing that makes all of us move, talk. Everything that we do is provided by that spirit, by that soul that able to make us do what we're doing, move, talk, feel, all those things. Then we have the inner part, that's the Ruach. It's a much inner part that a person has within himself. That's much higher level, that's much more spiritual. That is what a person really needs to feel is entering to when he goes into the shul. You enter the walls of the shul, and you're entering the time of tefillah, the time of davening. A person should not have his mind other places, but rather within the ability to realize that you're connecting with HaKadosh Baruch Hu, which is really going into your inner part of the nefesh, and afterwards the ruach. That is one element. Then we speak about a second element. We need to realize that the shul is not just a regular building that people gather together in order to pray. Not at all. Because it's explained in the Sfarim, Rav Shimshon Pinkus brings this down in Tiferet Shimshon, that you have three different parts that the Shekhinah went through. Three different stages. The first stage, the Shekhinah was all around the world. The Shekhinah of HaKadosh Baruch Hu dwelled around the entire world. That's what it says in the Pasuk, when Adam HaRishon felt that Ruach Elokim mitalechet bagan, which means he felt it. It was something tangible. You could feel something. For instance, when you walk around a forest and there's trees around you and grass and bushes, and you look all around to make sure that there's no dangerous animals, no snakes, no bears, nothing there. And you keep your ear tuned to make sure that there's nothing coming. When you hear the bushes move a little bit, you realize there's got to be something there. Whether it's a rabbit, whether it's a squirrel, whether it's something else, there's got to be something there moving it. Because you feel the bushes or the trees or the leaves move around you all the time. That's something that you keep tuned and you keep in mind. And that's what it was, Lehavdil, with Adam Rishon. He went through the gun, through the garden, and he felt, Ruach Elokim mitalechet. He felt it. It was felt. It was something that every person that was there was able to feel, because HaKadosh Baruch Hu Shekhinah was right then and there throughout the entire world. After the sin of Adam Rishon, HaKadosh Baruch Hu left. He couldn't live anymore in this world. He can't live amongst sin. And he went away from that world. But he wanted still to dwell in this world, and therefore, when Am Yisrael were ready to build the Mishkan, he asked them, "Asuli Mishkan, Shachanti Betocham, build me a building, a dwelling place that I can be amongst you." And that was the Mishkan and also the Bet Hamikdash. When Am Yisrael sinned with that as well, HaKadosh Baruch Hu left the Mishkan and the Beit HaMikdash as well. And he went to Olamot HaElyonim, to the spiritual upper worlds, and is not anymore in this world in any way. But we need to realize that HaKadosh Baruch Hu still left his Shekhinah in one place, and that is in a shul, in the Beit HaKnesset, in Batei Midrashot. And this is what it says in Megillah Kaftet. The Gemara says, Vayili lahem lemikdash me'at, I will be for them for a mini mikdash, mini Beit HaMikdash. Amar Rav Yitzchak, Rav Yitzchak says, Elu Batei Knesiyot uVatei Midrashot sheBeBavel, which means HaKadosh Baruch Hu still dwells in Beit HaMikdash. Where? The Beit HaMikdash, the mini Beit HaMikdash, the small version of Beit HaMikdash. Those are the shuls, those are the Batei Midrashot. And the Mefarshim learned that it's literal, it's not like some kind of hint, idea, feeling, anything like that, Musar, Divrei Musar, Ashkafa. No, it's literal. It's so much so that this is a halakha. First, it's brought down in the Gemara that we just mentioned, Megillah Kaftet. It's also in the Zohar, in a very open Zohar that explains that. And also, it's halakha. For instance, the Chayadam brings down, Mikdashit Tirah, you should fear the Bet HaMikdash. What is that? Says the Chayadam, Lo Bet HaMikdash Bilvad. That Pasuk doesn't say only one needs to fear the Bet HaMikdash. No. Ela Kol Makom HaMekudash, any place that has Kedusha. What is that? Bet HaKnesset uVet HaMidrash Nikraim Mekdash Me'at. Dichti Vayilahem LeMikdash Me'at. Elu Batei Knesiyot uVatei Midrashot. Those are the Mikdash Me'at. And he continues and says, Chayei Adam, וכתבו הפוסקים שמצווה זו לירה מן המקדש נוהג בבית הכנסת ובבית המדרש מדאורייתא, which means it's literal, it's מדאורייתא. Today that you have a shul is not something that a gathering place with four walls and a hechal. No, it is a mini Bet HaMikdash. And that's how Rav Shimshon Pinkus explains. He says that people make a mistake. They think that a shul is something that resembles maybe Beit HaMikdash, but it's not real Beit HaMikdash. He says, no, you have to realize. He brings a parable, a mashal, interesting mashal, with a tape recorder, let's say with a phone. It used to be 20 years ago, 30 years ago, that we had like these huge phones, big phones, and if you wanted to dial, you had to dial. It was a whole big piece. And if you wanted to make it smaller, you would have to cut it, let's say, to half. It wouldn't be a phone anymore. It wouldn't work. It would not have any effect anymore. So what would you do in order for you to be able to make it smaller? That came with time. Today, phones are very small already. They're very small. They're so small, and they carry so many different things that within them, within that phone, that it didn't lose anything. It's the same phone and could be much better. And in a much smaller version, it's mini. Same thing, let's say a tape recorder that we explained. It used to be like a very big piece. But within time, they made it very small, very tiny. You don't need to have that big thing anymore. It has everything that it was within a small piece. It's not the pshat that they took this tape recorder and they cut it to half and they made it smaller. Because if they would do that, it wouldn't work. Rather, in order for it to work, they had to do exactly what I just explained. They had to put everything in it in a mini version. And that's how Beit HaMikdash is. Beit HaMikdash was a dwelling place for HaKadosh Baruch Hu. It was a very big place, but a dwelling place for HaKadosh Baruch Hu. What happens is, once the Shekhinah had to leave, HaKadosh Baruch Hu still dwells amongst people. The Shekhinah of HaKadosh Baruch Hu is still here. Where? In Beit HaMikdash. So when a person walks into the shul, that's the place that HaKadosh Baruch Hu left the Shekhinah, in Batei Knesiyot uVatei Midrashot. When you enter that shul, you have to realize what it says in the Pasuk, that one needs to fear, Mikdashit Tirau, the fear that you have to have towards Beit HaMikdash is in full version of what it is today, shuls and Batei Midrashot. You can't talk in a shul. You can't act the way you would act outside the shul, because this is Beit HaMikdash. Imagine today you would have Beit HaMikdash in Yerushalayim. When HaKadosh Baruch Hu builds the Beit HaMikdash and sends us Mashiach, you would walk into the Beit HaMikdash, walk into the Hechal, to see Kohanim Bavodatam, Levim Beshiram, Israel Bemahamadam, and then all of a sudden your phone rings. And who is it? Your friends. Your friend from New York. Oh, hello, how you doing? What's going on? What's up? How's it going? Tell me about the game that you went yesterday with your friends. Hello? In Beit HaMikdash, HaKadosh Baruch Hu is here. The Shekhinah is concentrated over here. You have over here full voltage of the Shekhinah. Same thing in a shul. In a shul, you have all the elements of Beit HaMikdash, just in a smaller voltage of Shekhinah, which means you walk into the shul, everything over there operates the way it was in Beit HaMikdash, in a smaller voltage. That's all it is. But it's a Mikdash Me'at, and therefore we need to realize how important it is for us. We walk into the shul to do what? To do what we spoke before. You get into the inner part of yourself, and you connect with yourself and with the ultimate connection, and that is with HaKadosh Baruch Hu. How is this done? How is this done? This is done in a tefillah. A tefillah has in it olamot. The Mekubalim explains that you go up olamot, one olam after the other, until you reach the Amidah, Tefillat Amidah. That's the highest spiritual worlds. When we're talking about olamot, we're talking about spiritual worlds. And those worlds are going from the lowest world, and slowly, slowly you're building yourself. Psukei de Zimra, then Birkot Kriyat Shema, then you go to Kriyat Shema. Afterwards, you get to Amidah. You reach out with that, the highest olam. When you go up and up and up, that part that you're reaching now is something that extremely, extremely elevated. And that is when you're standing right now in front of HaKadosh Baruch Hu with your actions that are so elevated. So we're talking about something that's very interesting. You're talking about actions that are very elevated with a person that was able to reach the most inner part of himself, which is the most elevated of himself. That is the Ruach that we spoke. Remember that we went through the steps. When we walk into the walls and inside the Beit HaMikdash Me'at, that is the Shul, that is the Hechal. From the Hechal, the building, the house, we able to reach out with our Levush, which means you have to come also respectful to the Shul. You can't just dress with clothing that are not respectful to meet HaKadosh Baruch Hu and to actually get into the inner part of yourself with just regular clothing. You have to wear respectful clothing for the tefillah, especially that you come to the house of Hashem. Afterwards, you reach the guf. The guf has to be as well prepared to do the avodat Hashem of tefillah. Preparation can be done in many different ways. The halacha asks that a person should be prepared. Ikon likrat Elokecha Israel. One needs to prepare himself, whether he needs to first go to the bathroom and clean himself, he has to wash his hands, he has to make sure that he's calm, he's concentrated, and then when a person feels all those feelings that he walked into a place of Shekhinah, and you have to realize that when you walk into a shul, you have to feel that in one hand that the shul is a very, very holy place, that you can't act like yourself. But on the other hand, although it says Bevet Elokim Nialech Beragesh, you have to walk in the shul and you have to feel you have to feel tense in a way. It's a high voltage of Shekhinah, as we explained right now. So Bevet Elokim Nialech Beragesh, you have to feel that feeling of Beragesh. But on the other hand, you can't feel like the feeling, when can I get out? When can I go around about my day? When can I can't be here too long. It's not like when you go to a meeting with somebody, a high official person, and you meet with him and you're just thinking to yourself, let it be over already and let me get out of here. That's not supposed to be the feeling when we're going to the shul, because on the other aspect of the shul, it's Ashrei Yoshvei Vetecha. You have to feel that it's your house. Ashrei Yoshvei Vetecha is talking about the Betecha, the house of Hashem. And Ashrei Yoshvei Vetecha, those that sit in your house. So when you sit in the house of Hashem, you have to feel like it's your house as well. And only then, when you feel good in that place, you feel good, but you feel that you understand that it needs to be respected to the heart, to the most extreme. You can't just talk the way you want. You can't sit the way you want. You can't like put one foot on the other, and you can't like be half laying on the chair. No, you have to sit in respect. But on the other hand, you have to feel good about the place. You have to connect with the place. You have to feel that this is our house. Secondly, we spoke about the clothing. A person needs to come with such clothing. Second, third, person needs to be calm. His body needs to be prepared, which means sometimes a person wakes up in the morning and he feels that he has a headache if he doesn't drink a coffee. So how could he pray like that? You can't pray like that. Go take a coffee. Coffee is permitted to drink before tefillah. You can't have a meal, but you could drink coffee to come and feel that you are prepared, your body is prepared. Now you can sit down calmly and pray. And then you connect with the nefesh and the ruach. You go inside, in the person himself, the mensch, in the building itself that we explained that right now, it's the voltage of the Beit HaMikdash, as we explained that the levels of the Shekhinah came down from leaving the world, but on the other hand, leaving still the high voltage of the Shekhinah in Batei Mikdashot uVatei Midrashot. And thirdly, going up the ladder for the Tefillah. When you go up the ladder of the Tefillah, you reach the highest level of all when you actually reach the time of Amidah. But all the levels beforehand also are very elevated levels. So you have to treat it alike. You're right now in a spiritual high level. You have to realize that and recognize that. And you can't do whatever you want, because if you do, you can ruin the whole building. You're building something very delicate over here. It's like a building of cards that you're building. Or you put one leg on top of the other. Sometimes kids play like this and they just build one leg on top of the other and they go very high. But they realize that it's very delicate. Any little wind, any little move, even if you don't touch it, could make the whole thing crumble and fall. When we are in tefillah, we're doing exactly the same thing in a spiritual world. And therefore, it's very delicate. One needs to realize that you shouldn't treat it as you would treat something that's chol. This is kodesh. And fourth is the aspect of time. There are times that are more elevated. There are times that are much more elevated than others. For instance, Shabbat is much higher elevated time than Yom Chol. And therefore your tefillah on Shabbat reaches out much higher places in the spiritual worlds than your tefillah on Yom Chol. Same thing with holidays. The chagim, some chagim have such powers that you reach with them such high worlds. This is all in depth in Kabbalah, explained in length in the Kabbalah. One of those times that are very elevated is Chodesh Elul. Right now we're in Chodesh Elul. Chodesh Elul is a time that HaKadosh Baruch Hu comes closer to us. And because of that, that time is also much more elevated. And imagine Shabbat in Chodesh Elul, we're reaching Shabbat. Shabbat in Chodesh Elul, it's a combined Kedusha within Kedusha. It's closeness within closeness. So now you align everything together. How beautiful it is. You put everything and everything aligned one with the other. You have the aspect of the Kedusha of the Shul. You have the aspect of the Kedusha of the person that reach out the highest level of himself. You have the aspect of the action that he's doing, and this is the action of speaking to HaKadosh Baruch Hu on the highest level of all. And you have the aspect of the time, Elul, Shabbat within Elul. Unbelievable, soon we're reaching Rosh Hashanah also. Such high levels, you align all of them together. The power of that is like a nuclear bomb. It's much more than that. It's something that you can change worlds within that. And because of that, that you have the ability to change worlds, what happens is, the way HaKadosh Baruch Hu created and worked out for things is that the time that you reach those, you'll be able to bring down Ashpa'ah to this world. Ashpa'ah means all kind of wealth, whether it's physical wealth or emotional wealth or physical wealth or spiritual wealth, whatever it is. All those things that HaKadosh Baruch Hu provides us in this world are elements that are brought down in the Tefilla. And when a person realizes that, he's able to work and bring down much more of that Ashpa'ah, that wealth that we're talking about. So who doesn't need so many things from HaKadosh Baruch Hu, whether it's health? Person needs health. So many people are sick. So many people around us are not doing well. How do you change that? Well, the Kabbalah explains that when you do all those that I explained to you before, align them together in the tefillah and do it seriously, that comes down in the most beautiful and most powerful way. And that is how you change things. Whatever you need. Some people need parnasa. Some people need shiduchim. Some people need other things. This is how you can reach out the place of HaKadosh Baruch Hu that opens up the door to everything, all this good to come down. It's called Ashpa'ah. HaKadosh Baruch Hu is mashpia to this world. But this is Aliyah veKotzba. It's a beautiful thing. It's a thick, fatty, good thing, but it has also a thorn. With thorn, what a thorn does is that sometimes you have a very big, nice balloon, and sometimes it's a balloon that you can go with it to the sky. And if you have a thorn, you can just puncture that balloon, and the whole thing, all the air comes out, everything explodes and comes down, and you have nothing left. What is that thorn that could explode everything and just ruin the whole package that we just explained, that could bring you so much beautiful and good? That thorn is talking in tefillah. Why is that? Because talking tefillah shows that you don't understand and you don't realize or you don't appreciate all that we spoke about. And just a simple mashal, if you had the ability to go to the highest king, at the time there were kings, let's say today, you go to the president, and you really need to ask him for something, for Klal Yisrael, something that really could change our problems that we have in Klal Yisrael and make things much better. And you prepare yourself, and you go over there, and you dress up, and you rehearse what you want to say over and over, and finally you sit down and it is a good mood, and you can get out of him whatever it is that you need for Klal Yisrael. You go with a shlichut. You have something really to gain over here. It's not a simple thing. You understand how elevated it is. And for that, the president listens, and he's convinced. And he says, you know what? Sounds good. Let's make it. Let's change. Let's make it more comfortable for Am Yisrael. Let's make it more safe for Am Yisrael. Whatever it is. All of the sudden, your phone rings and you pick up the phone while you're speaking to the president. You pick up the phone and lo and behold, it's somebody from work, and you start talking to him. Do this, why don't you go over there? You need to get the money, go to the bank, bring it down. You 1 minute on the phone, you close it, you say, excuse me, and you close it. Do you have anything more disrespectful than that? What you did is not only disrespectful, but it shows that you don't realize that you can gain so much more from your meeting right now than the small conversation that you had with your worker, that you should go to the bank and deposit the $100 check that you received from work. If you don't realize that, so the president says, you know what? Forget about the whole deal. be well, goodbye. And that's what happens with a Kadosh Baruch Hu. Kadosh Baruch Hu says, you know what? I'll give you anything you want. You reach out to me, and this is the steps that you need to do. But when you're there, and you're able to get there, and you have everything handed out to you, the shul's now open, you can go there. We have respectful clothing, you go there, you have your tefillin, you have a siddur, you have everything. You sit down, and you're ready to actually bring down the shefa, and HaKadosh Baruch Hu is listening, and he's willing to do it. And it's exactly at that time that HaKadosh Baruch Hu is ready already. He's there. He's in a meeting with you. It's the high Kedusha that HaKadosh Baruch Hu left throughout the whole world. Just in that place. Just in that shul. Just for us. Special for us. To connect with us. So we can come and ask him. You pick up the phone. And you have a 1 minute conversation with your worker. Or in the middle of Tefillah. In the middle of Sukkah de Zimra. Your friend is saying something. And you answer him. What happens is that you take that thorn into the balloon and you puncture the balloon and everything explodes. You get nothing out of it, unfortunately. And this is such a big musaf for us. We need to realize, we need to understand that tefillah is something that Chazal tell us, Krum Zulut Livnei Adam. What is that? Krum Zulut. Zulut means a person that feels something very zol, very cheap. What does a person feel that's very cheap? That he doesn't respect, he doesn't know how to appreciate? Chazal tell us that's tefillah. Dvarim shomdim berumo shel olam, Chazal tell us. V'anashim mezalzelim bahem. What does that mean? What stands berumo shel olam? The highest places in the world. Says Chazal tefillah. Tefillah, that's what it is. You're davening, you're talking to Hashem. That's the highest thing that you could do. There's a lot of high things you can do. You can learn, and you can do mitzvot, and you can do tzedakah, and so on and so forth. But the connection with HaKadosh Baruch Hu to bring down the shefa is done in tefillah. If you do it in other ways, you bring in it close to be able to bring down all those that we spoke. But when you pray, just like Rashi tells us in Parashat Bereshit, that before there was a person to pray for rain, Kadosh Baruch Hu didn't bring rain. Although there was need for rain, nothing grew without rain. But since there was nobody asking for rain, Kadosh Baruch Hu didn't bring it, although it's needed. Once Adam created rain, and he's able to pray for rain, then the rain will come down. Kadosh Baruch Hu has for us beautiful things to give us. But we need to be able to know how to ask from HaKadosh Baruch Hu. And asking from HaKadosh Baruch Hu and davening has its rules. You have to be respectful. You're respectful? It's Krum Zulut Levnei Adam, Dvarim Shomdim Berumo Shel Olam. This is highest of the highest. But unfortunately, we should not ruin it by the thorn that blows the balloon, Krum Zulut Levnei Adam, by just disrespecting that what we're doing. This is something that we need to cherish, something that we need to realize the importance. Bezrat Hashem, I hope this message goes to our heart, my heart, and we'll be able to make a difference in this Elul, a difference in this Rosh Hashanah. We see how much suffering there was this year. So much suffering. And Bezrat Hashem, with our tefillah, we could change that. Chazak uvaruch for Chazak, for Torah Anytime, and all those that are involved.